Hi, I saw a college kid with weird jerks that happens, and then he went into a party, sit up late at night, and he consumed alcohol, and in the morning, 3 a.m., he was found by his college and roommate to having generalized seizures, shaking all over. Then he brought him to the clinic, and then we made the diagnosis of juvenile myoclonic epilepsy. So let's talk in details about juvenile myoclonic epilepsy and this unique type of epilepsy, and give you all the new updates and treatments that are available for now. Welcome to the Epilepsy Encyclopedia, where you find all the information you need about epilepsy, and this is your epilepsy specialized neurologist, Dr. Omar Danoun. Juvenile myoclonic epilepsy is one of the most common generalized epilepsy syndromes in children, and it is important to make the right diagnosis and the right treatment, because some medications can worsen this condition, so it's very, very important to be aware of it. By the name implies, it is in the juvenile years, so it happens in the ages of 12 to 18 years of old most of the time, and it can be seen later in life, and they will have some myoclonic jerks and other types of seizures. And I have seen a patient who was first time diagnosis of juvenile myoclonic epilepsy in her age of 65. So it can happen at any age, but most of the time in the juvenile years. The seizures happen in early awakening will be myoclonic jerks. Those jerks are shaking all over the body. Like you see in this child, it's not a juvenile, but it happens. Those myoclonic jerks happen at any age. So it will be happening like this in the early morning, and the child will be having those jerks, will drop the spoon, drop the cereal. And I have a kid that has all of those stains from the cereal and the morning breakfast. And I call it the dirty rug syndrome because of all the stains in the room. So that's happens a lot. And then the other seizure types can be generalized tonic-clonic seizures, which is shaking all over, or grand mal seizures, which is the old name for it. And in some cases, we'll have absence seizures, which is the staring spells. So those are the three types of seizures that can happen in juvenile myoclonic epilepsy. What causes juvenile myoclonic epilepsy? The cause of JME is complex genetic etiology. It means complex genetic causes that are multiple genes that control the electricity in the brain. So the genes will produce proteins, and those proteins are the building blocks of the channels and the receptors that control the flow of electricity in the brain. So those genes can be affected and causing increased electricity in the brain. And this is called generalized because it's all over in every building block of the brain. And it causes those myoclonic seizures and its type of epilepsy. And we can test for that. We can do genetic panels to see the exact genes. But most of the time, the gene panel would be negative or not very revealing. Though most of the mutations are novel new mutations or de novo mutations that happens in the child and the children themselves did not inherited from their parents. But there are some cases of familial juvenile myoclonic epilepsy. If you have any questions, feel free to write a comment with your question. And I do go live multiple times, so it's the best way to answer your question is to ask me them live. So make sure you subscribe to this channel and hit the notification bell, so every time I go live, you'll be notified so that you can ask your questions or comment on the latest video. And now consultations are available with me directly, so I can give you a remote second opinion and consultation if you're with the treatment, and you can come to United States or to my hospital to be treated by me directly. And I will leave the information about this consultation in the description of the video. How do you make the diagnosis of juvenile myoclonic epilepsy? The diagnosis is done by the clinical features, how the seizures are. So we have those three seizure types, the myoclonic jerks, the jerking all over, mostly happens in the upper part of the body, the arms and the face and the head. It rarely happens in the leg, and the generalized tonic-clonic seizures and absence seizures. So all of those are the seizure types, and we can do supportive testing, which is an EEG. That EEG is a brainwave test we do to measure the electricity in the brain. And in juvenile myoclonic epilepsy, you will see this generalized discharges all over the brain, like you see in this picture, that you can see the discharges are all over the brain from top to bottom, and they are the typical polyspike discharges. So they are characteristics of juvenile myoclonic epilepsy. And it is important when we do the EEG to take a long time of the EEG at between 30 minutes to 1 hour, and longer EEG is necessary sometimes if the first EEG is normal. And it is advised to have a photic stimulation, which is flashing lights during the EEG, and hyperventilation, breathing fast. All of those can trigger the discharges to happen more. And we do sleep during the EEG, which are increasing the chances of capturing any abnormal activity. And we end up seeing about 70% of the time that they have positive EEG findings when we do it. Imaging, like a brain MRI, is not necessary in juvenile myoclonic epilepsy. If there is like a typical case, EEG findings and typical seizures, you don't need to do an MRI. And MRI by default is normal in this condition. There are other associated conditions and comorbidities that can happen with juvenile myoclonic epilepsy. And most important ones are psychiatric comorbidities such as anxiety, depression, and personality disorders and impulsivity, which can happen in children of this diagnosis. So it is very important to screen for them and identify them and be careful with anti-seizure medications that can worsen anxiety and depression, such as levetiracetam or Keppra. It can worsen and should not be given in anybody who have a history of those psychiatric conditions. Listen to this. There is a variant of, like, similar to juvenile myoclonic epilepsy, but not really the case of what we call progressive myoclonic epilepsy. So progressive myoclonic epilepsy is a genetic condition as well that has myoclonic jerks and generalized tonic-clonic seizures, but there will be progressive delay and worsening of the case over time. And there is regression and worsening of movements and everything. So it is a specific diagnosis that is different than juvenile myoclonic epilepsy. But I wanted to just mention it here because it has kind of relevant features. The myoclonic jerks will get worse with time and the child will stop being able to walk and talk and so on. Such diagnoses are Lafora body disease, myoclonic epilepsy with ragged red fibers, neural ceroid lipofuscinosis, dentato, rubro, pallido, Lucian atrophy. Very complex name of all those changes in the brain that get atrophied, and Gaucher's disease. All of those are different diagnoses that tend to get worse with time and completely different conditions. What are the seizure triggers in JME? The most important seizure triggers are sleep deprivation and alcohol consumption and missing medications. Those are the main triggers for seizures and should be avoided in all cases. And sometimes some cases will have photosensitivity, which means that flashing lights will induce their seizures. And we can even test for that by doing photic stimulation during the EEG and capture that. How do we treat juvenile myoclonic epilepsy? The first step is to know the medicine that we should not do and use for juvenile myoclonic epilepsy, including the family of sodium channel blockers such as carbamazepine or tigritol, phenytoin or dilantin, vigabatrin, gabapentin, and tiagabine. All of those medications can worsen the seizures in juvenile myoclonic epilepsy. The length of treatment for juvenile myoclonic epilepsy is very long and should be, most of the cases will need lifelong treatment because there is changes and there are mutations in the channels that are the building blocks of the brain. And those medications, anti-seizure medications, will calm down the electricity but will never change the building of the brain. So it is better to continue the medications for a very long time. I have a patient with JME. She was seizure-free for 22 years. And when she stopped the medications, 2 years later, seizures came back. We have multiple medications that are successful in JME and can be used. And the most successful treatment is Valproic acid or Depakote. This medicine works very well for myoclonic jerks and for all types of seizures. And it is important to know that Depakote and valproic acid is not safe in pregnancy, so we should avoid it, or we should at least know that it is not safe in pregnancy and avoid it in women of childbearing age and girls because of that potential for pregnancy and being not safe. But we give it in multiple cases and it can be a very good treatment. And I made a whole video about valproic acid and how to use it and what are the side effects, that you can check it out. Other effective treatments is Lamotrigine or Lamictal. which is a good medicine that is mood stabilizer, that is antidepressant, and it is safe in pregnancy, so it can be a good choice. But we should know that some cases, that the myoclonic jerks can get worse with lamotrigine, so we should watch for that if it happens. The other option is levetiracetam, or the favorite medicine of all time is Keppra. I feel that everybody gets Keppra whenever they have a seizure. It's kind of like seizure is Keppra for like in the emergency department. But Keppra, yes, it's a good medicine. It's safe in pregnancy. It does not have any like major side effects except the ones about psychiatric side effects. So we should know that Keppra is not safe in patients with anxiety, depression, PTSD, or bipolar, or any personality disorder, because it can get those conditions to get worse. So it's very important to avoid them in any of patients who have those conditions. Otherwise, they will come back very angry at you and in the clinic. Other options will be Topiramate or Topamax, which is a medicine that works well for generalized epilepsy. I made a whole video about Topamax. You can check it out. But the most side effects that you will think about is like cognitive difficulties. It can affect the eye, increase the pressure, cause glaucoma, and it can cause tingling in the hands, which is benign, and cause kidney stones and decrease sweating. And it is not very safe in pregnancy. Other treatments can be Zonisamide and Lacosamide or Vimpat. Those medications are good for juvenile myoclonic epilepsy. And we are testing other new treatments for this condition. And once they are approved, we will let you know about them. And once they are out. What if the medications do not work for me? Yes, medications can work in the majority of cases, about 70%, but unfortunately, about 30% of cases, the medications will not work, and we call this drug-resistant epilepsy, and it can happen a lot in patients with juvenile myoclonic epilepsy. In this case, we need to do alternative treatments, and some treatments that have been tried are surgical treatments, including the stimulation devices with vagus nerve stimulation. When we implant the vagus nerve device in the vagus nerve here, and that will stimulate the brain, and it helps with cutting down the seizure frequency by at least 50% in 50% of the patient, and it helps to decrease the intensity and severity of seizures. And the other treatment is also the deep brain stimulation, or DBS device, which is wires are implanted inside the brain in the strategic place in the area of the brain called the thalamus. And now we are looking at different targets, and in the generalized epilepsy and juvenile myoclonic epilepsy, we are testing the centromedian nucleus, CM, rather than the classic anterior nucleus of the thalamus. So we are kind of testing the best parameters and best locations to implant this device. And there are new clinical trials and studies being done for responsive neurostimulation RNS device in juvenile myoclonic epilepsy. One of the other treatments is the ketogenic diet, which can be modification in the diet that helps with seizures. And to learn all about the ketogenic diet and how can it be done and what are the benefits and the side effects of this diet, you can see this video for all the information about the ketogenic diet. And stay healthy, and see you in the next one. Salam.